Everyone is safe and secure at their homes and quarantining themselves to the best of their abilities. Good morning, all of you. I would like to introduce myself as Rupal Agrawal. I'm an ex-employee of L&T. I'm currently looking for a suitable next opportunity. Through the invite of Professor Ankita, I'm here to share my experience and knowledge about project cost management, which I've gained through 9.5 years of my extensive work in Larsen & Toubro Limited. So I would just like to start here. Okay, the topic contains project cost management. I would like to first tell you about what is a project. So my next slide goes like this. What is a project? A project is something which has a definite goal and an objective. Suppose I'll just let you an example. If you are building a house, suppose you are building your own house, you are arranging something to build your own house. So what is your project for you? Building a completed house. So that is a project for you. Manufacturing a car is not a project. Let me tell you, manufacturing a car is a process and not a project. Because manufacturing a car...
Kindly mute. Everyone, kindly mute your mics, please.
Can I continue?
Yeah, please.
Sure. So manufacturing a car, as I said, is not a project, it's a process. Because you manufacture a car, then you manufacture a car again, and then it continues. Like it has no end. So my definition of a project is you have a defined goal. You have a specific, some specific task to be performed. Like I would like to say an example of building a house. It has some specific task to be performed. It has to be, the walls has to be built, the roof has to be laid, the walls has to be brickwork, it has to be plastered, it has to be painted, then every fittings has to be performed. And so there are some specific tasks which has to be performed. It has a definite beginning at an end. That is very important, because a project generally has, a process generally do not has a definite end. It has a beginning, but it may continue and continue till the company runs out. But a project has a definite start and a definite end. And the next most important thing is the resources are being consumed. If you are trying to build a project, some resources are to be consumed, which is basically labor, material, plant and machinery, and some specialization works which needs to be performed. So project is actually resources that are being consumed. It's called a project. Now, project has a predetermined objectives. As I said, it has a predetermined objectives. So the predetermined objectives are basically cost, time, and performance. You have a budget in which the project has to be completed, and you have a timeline. These are the two most important aspects of a project. It has a cost associated. We cannot just build a project and spend crores and crores of rupees on it. It has a definite budget under which it has to be built. Suppose you are building a house, so you have 10 lakhs to 15 lakhs of rupees which is to be kept for building a house. You cannot just spend crores and crores and just keep on spending. You have a definite budget. If you're buying a car, so you have a definite budget. You have a time in a project. Suppose you have to build a house. So maybe that can be completed in a year or maybe completed in a 2 year, but it has to be completed within a certain amount of time. You cannot just prolong it, because that will reduce your profit, I would say. Then it has some performance. It has some performance basically in the sense safety, quality, and customer satisfaction. If you're buying a house, the most important thing is safety, so that no one is getting injured and none of the persons who are involved in project execution are getting injured. So safety is most important. When in India, the trend of what to say, project is performance in the sense you have to complete the job, then quality, then safety. These are prioritization of a project in India. But in US and other major countries, safety, they are keeping safety as the foremost importance in construction projects. Safety, they are keeping on first point. Without safety, nothing can be done. So safety is the first priority, then quality, then the performance of the project. So in that way, it goes in all over the world. In India, we generally tend to avoid safety, but with the trends going up and all that, the safety is giving far more importance than everything else. Now, I would like to achieve the project progress or to achieve the project outcome. Basically, our company follows a typical planning tool which is called MPCS. It is called Management Planning and Control System, which is generally prepared at site. So we have 10 schedules over here, which basically covers all the project timelines. We have S0 to S10, S0 being the master schedule. See, a construction project and basically a project, we need to answer 4 W's and 1 H. The 4 W's are what is to be done, when it is to be done, what are the resources required to be completed, what are the tools and tackles which is required to be completed, and H means how it is to be done. When we try to answer these 4 W's and 1 H, we get a project. So to answer all these, we have some 10 schedules which we prepare based on their frequency, based on their importance. Some are prepared monthly, some are prepared weekly, some are prepared bi-monthly, some are prepared bi-weekly, and so on. So the basic tool which is to be prepared is the SD, master schedule, which is the construction program. The construction program tells you what is to be done and when it is to be done. Right? It contains a series of I do not have a format of the same, or else I would have shown you all the 10 formats. The construction program, you might have all the students might have heard about Primavera or basically Microsoft Project. Anyone has heard about Microsoft Project or Primavera?
Primavera is for scheduling.
That is the master schedule is for scheduling. The scheduling contains the list of activities, interlinked list of activities along with the timelines associated with it. So we have what is to be done and when it is to be done. If we are able to answer these two questions, the rest of the schedules follow. When we have the final master construction program or master schedule, then we have the schedule of invoicing. The schedule of invoicing basically contains what amount of money we are going to claim from client if we done a certain amount of work according to our S0 or according to our construction program. That is the schedule of invoicing. Suppose we have a bill of quantities and then we construct, suppose we try to build a house. So as long as we cannot just wait for the client to give us money when our whole building is completed. To improve our cash flow and to have some cash in hand, suppose we build a wall. So by building a wall and it amounts to about 10% of the total project value, so we claim 10% of the project value. Suppose the project value is 100 rupees and the 10% of the 100 rupees is 10 rupees. So as soon as we build a wall of our whole house, we can claim 10 rupees from the client. So in that way, our cash flow goes down because everyone works for us. Because we build a house, the client pays us, and the person who has built the house for us, we need to pay them also. So whatever we claim from client, we need to pay to the subcontractor, or we need to pay to the person who is actually building the wall. आप अपने घर पे घर बनवा रहे हो तो आप दीवार build कर रहे हो तो आप उसको पैसे दोगे so that उसने जो काम किया उसको पैसा मिल सके. The next thing is schedule of milestone events. Milestone events means achieving interim milestones. You have when you try to go from I would like to say Delhi to Varanasi, so you have a different milestones to achieve. The meenil ka patthar jisko kehte hai na. So milestones you have to achieve. So when you reach a milestone, you mean some of the tasks have been completed. So you are pretty sure that this has to be completed in to monitor the complete construction program. You have a milestone program. Suppose the duration from Delhi to Varanasi takes about 10 hours. So you know that by 6 hours or by if you start at 10 a.m. So you know that by the time by 4 p.m. I need to reach Kanpur. So you whenever you try to reach Kanpur, you just have a quick feedback. Okay, I'm on time and I have reached Kanpur by 4 p.m. So I'll be able to reach Varanasi by 9 p.m. So that is the way it goes. Now S3 talks about schedule of plant and machinery. I said what is to be done and when it is to be done, right? Now the S3, S4, S5 talks about resources required. What are the major resources? Men, material, and machinery. You might have all mechanical engineers are here. You might have heard about all 3 M's, material, machinery. So S3 talks about schedule of plant and machinery. Means what machinery is to be deployed at what time and in what duration and in what numbers. So S3 talks about this. S4 talks about schedule of staff. Means you have a system, you have a project to be executed. Then you have a list of staff and you have a group of people who are going to execute a job. So S4 talks about schedule of staff, means what staff do we need at what time and what role they must be playing to achieve the project outcome. So that talks about schedule of staff. Similarly, S5 talks about schedule of labor. You have a construction worker. Typically, a project contains about 1,000 construction workers. So you have a schedule of labor. At what time, at what duration of the project you need, how much amount of labor? Suppose you need 100 by the end of 1 month, 200 by the end of 2 months. So this S5 talks about schedule of labor. S6 talks about schedule of bulk material. I would not say bulk material, I would say schedule of material. What material do you need at a specific point of time based on your S0, based on your construction program? Suppose you need to build a wall at the end of 2 months. So for building a wall, you need bricks, you need plaster, you need all the tools and tackles. So S6 talks about schedule of bulk material. Or I would say schedule of material. Similarly, S7 talks about schedule of specializations. Suppose you do not want to build a wall by local labors or by anything. You want to subcontract it to another agency who have specialization in building a wall. So you give a contract, just like your client has given a contract to you, you give a subcontract to other agency. Suppose I will pay you for building the complete wall, and since you are specialized in this, I will pay you this much amount of money. So S7 talks about schedule of specializations. At what time, for what construction, for what activity we need a specialization. S8 talks about schedule of direct cost. Yeah, we are building a project, so you need to take care of your cost also. So S8 talks about schedule of direct cost. And S9 talks about schedule of indirect cost. Direct cost means which is directly involved in construction of the project. Suppose your material, labor, staff, and all that. There are direct costs which are directly involved. Indirect cost is you need a temporary arrangement for building a house. Temporary arrangement, or indirect cost talks about all the other expenses that are not directly contributing to the project. That is only direct cost. That is direct, indirect cost. So we have schedules for S8 and S9, direct cost and indirect cost. S10 is finally schedule of liquidity forecast, cash flow. How much cash we have in hand. A good business, what do you mean by a good business? A good business is something in which aap apna paisa nahi lagate ho. So your cash flow should always be positive. Suppose you are claiming 100 rupees from client and you are paying 80 rupees to your subcontractors, that means you are having 20 rupees as your cash. That means cash flow. Your cash flow has always has to be positive. Please keep in mind. So these are the 10 schedules which forms the basis of any construction industry. Now I'll talk about my main topic, which is project costing, and which talks about project cost estimation, accepted cost estimate, and job cost report. Now, finance mantra, as you are already aware, you must have read in mathematics, gross margin is equal to sales minus cost. A project cannot run on charity, that is for sure. Whatever you are spending, you need to have some profit, without which you cannot operate. So gross margin is what basically everyone works in any industry. So gross margin is basically sales minus cost. It is as simple as that. It is a basic general formula which you have been studying in from class first and second, or basically from class fifth. Gross margin is sales minus cost. Now gross margin has different terminologies, or you say it is the result expected by management, and we have to ensure that this is positive always. It has to be there. Without bina paise ke kaam nahi hota, aur bina profit ke koi kaam nahi karte. So it is what is actually expected. Gross margin, we need to have some profit before we execute a project. After executing a project, or else there is no point of executing a project. Charity mein to kuch bhi kaam kar sakte ho. So a project must have a gross margin. Sales is generally fixed in construction projects. Suppose the client wants you to build a house and the client says we'll pay 10 lakh rupees for building a house. So this 10 lakh rupees is your sales, which is absolutely fixed. You cannot change. You cannot change unless and until clients wants an addition or deletion in that. So it is written mostly fixed in construction projects, but the possibilities to increase the sales has to be explored. In what ways can you increase? You have to negotiate, or suppose if client has asked you to do some extra amount of work beyond the scope which is there in the contract. So you need to find out the possibilities in which you can increase your sales. The moment you increase your sales, the gross margin will increase, because sales is on the positive side and cost is on the negative side. But to increase the sales, the cost, if the cost increases the proportionality, then your gross margin will remain the same. So you have to make sure the sales in proportion increases more than the cost, because if your sales increases, the cost will also increase, but the sales should increase more in proportion than the cost. So the sales is generally fixed in any construction projects. See, now moving on to the cost. Cost is the only tool that we have in our hands and which we can control to have better results. Suppose aap kharcha nahi kar sakte, aap kharcha bachaoge to aapke paas profit aayega. It is as simple as that. If you restrict your cost, you are going to increase your gross margin. It is as simple as that. So this is the finance mantra. You all are very, very, very much aware. Anyone is having any doubt, you can interrupt in between and then I can clear off and then move on. Thank you so much. Now, in L&T construction, you see project cost has three components, which I've already talked about. Cost of works, that is the cost of direct works. Cost of overheads, which is the cost of indirect works or indirect cost. And cost of plant, which is the cost of plant and machinery. Now, this cost of plant and machinery is again allocated to cost of works and cost of overheads. I'll just give you all examples of these, how it is booked and what do we mean by cost of works and cost of overheads. I'll just let you know in subsequent slides. See, we have some parameters to define a project. I'll come to it a little later. I'll just explain you this part, cost of works and cost of overheads. See, cost has so many parts. Like, we have a P&M hire cost, we have a pure labor hire cost, we have a material hire, we have a material cost, we have a overheads cost, and we have a specialized agency. I said three M's are there. This labor and specialized agencies are combined to make it as labor. Then we have material, then we have plant and machinery, and then we have overheads. These are the major components of cost. Now, coming on to the direct cost. See, for building a house, or you're basically mechanical engineering guys, so I would like to quote example of mechanical HVAC, firefighting, plumbing. See, HVAC, firefighting, plumbing, we have put in direct cost. So each of the direct, we have a recon course. What the recon course means, reconciliation course. You cannot, to monitor the project progress, we disintegrate all the costs into sub major heads. Similar type of works are put together so that we monitor the cost with respect to the recon course. We have some, suppose a building of a house contains different amount of work. Suppose we have to do excavation, we have to do earthwork means ghatta khodna, or ghatta khodke fir jo foundation hum lay karte hain, then we pour the concrete. Reinforcement tying करते हैं, then we do concreting works. These constitute like direct cost. The indirect cost constitutes staff salaries, safety expenses, water and power, whatever are the temporary arrangements which are required to do the project. There are called indirect cost. So every recon code is placed separately for identifying similar scope of work. Suppose earthwork cannot be compared to concrete, because concrete is a separate quantum of work and unit of work, and earthwork is a unit, separate unit of work. So we place earthwork in a separate recon code, we place concrete in a separate recon code, and we place reinforcement in a separate recon code, say WB10001, just to identify. And earthwork contains similar amounts, type of work, like excavation means digging a hole, then backfilling it, then compacting it, and then all that. Concreting works, say, suppose we have apne koi bhi building banti dekhi hogi to usme wo pillars khade hote columns, to usme concrete poured hota hai, wo different recon code mein put kiya jata hai, because inko different recon code mein se put kiya jata hai, because inki different unit of measurement hai. अर्थवर्क की यूनिट ऑफ मेजरमेंट है क्यूबिक मीटर और वो से मीटर क्यूब, कंक्रीट की भी मीटर क्यूब ही होती है, रीइंफोर्समेंट की जो सरिया होता है वो दैट इज मीट्रिक टन, वो मीट्रिक टन में आप मेजर करते हैं। इनडायरेक्ट कॉस्ट जो होता है स्टाफ सैलरी सेफ्टी एक्सपेंसेस ये आपकी लमसम होती है इन रुपीज, स्टैटिकली इन रुपीज, स्ट्रेट अवे इन रुपीज होती है, तो आपको इसमें कंसीडर करने की जरूरत नहीं है। अब जैसे आई विल टेल यू एन एग्जांपल, अब एक्सकेवेशन, दिस इज व्हाट आई वाज टेलिंग beforehand, excavation and related items are booked in earthworks. Similarly, plain cement concrete and reinforced cement concrete are booked in concrete. This mechanical guys are, I hope you are not able, I hope you are able to recognize PCC and RCC. If not, you can ask any civil engineering guy, he'll be able to tell you very briefly what is PCC and RCC. PCC means plain cement concrete where there is no reinforcement, just the bed of the foundation. And RCC means reinforced cement concrete where you tie the reinforcement and then pour the concrete. Now I would go back to this slide which I left out. Parameters to financially define a project. The three parameters are tendering cost estimate, accepted cost estimate, and job cost report. Suppose you want to build a project or you want to build a building. So tendering means आपने अखबार में सुना होगा ना इस चीज का टेंडर निकला है, what do you exactly mean by इस चीज का टेंडर निकला है? इस चीज का टेंडर निकला है का मतलब है कि the person who wants to build a project, who wants to build a building has estimated some cost, है ना? Suppose he has estimated to build a building, okay, this building will cost me around 50 crores of rupees. So invites a tender from different bidders, from different potential construction companies, जो ये काम कर सकती हैं. Suppose someone says, okay, आपने खर्चा निकाला था कि 50 crores में ये building बनेगी. Some says, okay, we'll do it in 40 crores. Some say we'll do it in 60 crores. Some say we'll do it in 70 crores. So tendering cost estimate is you estimate the project cost during the tender time itself. 50 crores is just tendering cost estimate. So some might quote 40 crores against this, some might quote 60 crores against this. So जिसने सबसे कम quote किया है 40 crores उसको आप cost दोगे, because आप अपना खर्चा बताना चाहते हो, tendering cost estimate से आप अपना खर्चा बताना चाहते हो. But you cannot just limitedly give a contract to person who is the lowest one. You have to find out the credentials of the same, whether the company is eligible to execute the project or not. You cannot just blindly award your tender to a person who is just quoting very less. You need to see the credentials of the company, whether it is capable of doing a similar project or not. Many things are there, whether it is financially secure or not. Many things are there. So these you need to cater so that your tendering cost estimate is prepared. So when the tender is prepared, it is done and you have awarded a project. So the project team develops a estimated cost estimate. So tendering cost estimate was 50 crores, right? You might have anticipated, okay, 50 crores was my what was my kharcha at the time of tender. Now what is my, what I have got my project and I have got client which is going to pay me 70 crores of rupees after including the profit into it. So 70 crores is my project value, that is my sales. So against the sales we need to establish a cost under which we'll be able to complete the project. So when we prepare the cost, it is called as cost estimate. It is not called as accepted. Unless and until it is accepted by the management, suppose 70 crores is your project value, is your sales. Suppose you prepare an estimated cost estimate of 60 crores. So that means you are declaring to the management that you are going to earn 10 crores as gross margin from this project. The management reviews and then it goes on for a period of around 1 month. The management reviews, okay, he says, no, you can complete the project in 50 crores only. So you are going to earn 20 crore rupees from this project. So the site team again recaptures what is left out, what is not left out. Then again, re-evaluation is done. Then you come, okay, sir, we'll not be able to do the project in 50 crores. We'll be able to complete the project in 55 crores. So earlier you prepared 60 crores estimate. The management says, no, you can complete the project in 50 crores. But now after reevaluating, you commit that, no, sir, 50 is not possible. Okay, we can achieve in 55 crores. So when 55 is accepted cost estimate, that means it is accepted by the management, and now you are bound to complete the project in 55 crores against a sales of 70 crores. That means you have signed an agreement with the management that you are going to earn 15 crores. 70 crores is the sales, 55 crores is the accepted cost estimate. So you are going to earn 15 crores from this project. I'll let you know the. So that is what it says. It is a detailed cost estimate prepared at the beginning of the project. Please understand, it is prepared at the beginning of the project for the quantities given in the BOQ. BOQ means bill of quantity. Suppose bill of quantity means what is to be done and how much quantity is to be done. It is all in a detailed document called BOQ, which is provided by the client. Or if it is a design build contract, you yourself will prepare the BOQ and estimate it to the management. It is the commitment by the site management to hire management in terms of percentage gross margin. As I said, you have committed to the management that you will earn 15 crores from a project of 70 crores. That means you are going to complete the project with a cost of 55 crores. That is the accepted cost estimate. It is a baseline to measure the financial performance of the project. So you have fixed a baseline. Okay, we have estimated that we will be completing the project in 55 crores, and we will not go beyond it. We will not go beyond 55. If you can close the project within 55, it is well and good for the project, and it is well and good for you because the management will appreciate your effort. But if it is going beyond 55, then you need to keep a check. Then we come on to the next thing. The next thing is job cost report. Job cost report is basically nothing but a measurement tool of accepted cost estimate. It is a monitoring tool of accepted cost estimate. As I said, the accepted cost estimate is prepared at the beginning of the project, but job cost report is prepared every month during the course of the project. Suppose your project duration is 10 months, and today is April. So your project duration is 10 months. So you'll be completing the project. You will be starting the project in April 2020, and you will be completing the project in January 2021. So the accepted cost estimate has to be prepared now. It has to be prepared and closed by April 2020. The job cost report is prepared every month during the duration. Suppose the job cost report will be prepared at the end of May, at the end of June, at the end of July, and till the end of the project, just to see where we are with respect to accepted cost estimate. It says illustrates the variation of actual cost incurred compared to the schedule cost. Schedule cost means the ACE cost, and helps in corrective action in case of cost overruns. Suppose if you are overrunning a particular recon code, or if you are overrunning a particular cost, then it needs a corrective action. Suppose you said that we'll be spending 5 crores in earthwork at the end of the project. You have already incurred 2 crores, and then you are expected, I'll just let you know the slides of that, and you are expected to, in suppose you have already spent 2 crores and your ACE was 5 crores. So you are left with 3 crores only to complete the balance amount of earthwork. So if you're completing the project, if you're completing the earthwork scope of work within 5 crores, then it is well and good. And if you're overrunning it, then we need to have a corrective action. Where the cost has gone wrong, where the cost has gone right, what needs to be done to prevent from going it beyond 5 crores. Projected total cost and contribution from the project shall be regularly assessed in comparison with the ACE. As I said, the JCR cost and the contribution of the GM, suppose you have contributed 55 crores. Now, after preparation of the JCR at the first month, you are targeting the we will be able to contribute only 14 crores. That means your cost is going beyond 55 crores. Then you need to keep a check and inform to the management that, okay, sir, we are overrunning of the cost. So you need to cross check, and then you need to come back to 55. I'll show you this. I wanted to show you. This is the typical JCR format. What to say? Job cost report format. It says job status till date. That means what has been spent actually, estimates to complete, what needs to be done beyond, what extra expenses more to be done, cost till date, what cost has to be incurred beyond this thing, and then the revised estimate. This plus this job status plus what is the ETC, estimates to complete, what is the balance cost that we are going to incur so that our revised estimate is come. Now this revised estimate is compared with original. Original means ACE. Understood? Now I will give you, I highlighted something as green. See, this is the recon code, subgrade. Subgrade means you lay your GSB and you lay your, what to say, जो आपका कंक्रीट के नीचे की जो सतह होती है ना, जो आपने देखा होगा लाल लाल जो रोड होती है जिसपे छोटे छोटे पत्थर और पत्थर और उसको लेके आते, दैट इज कॉल्ड सबग्रेड वर्क्स. सो सबग्रेड वर्क्स आई गेस इट इज ग्रीन इन कलर. ग्रीन इन कलर इन द सेंस द एस वाज 22.17 करोड़ एंड योर टोटल एस्टिमेट इज 21.28 करोड़. दैट मींस व्हाट यू प्रोजेक्टेड टू द मैनेजमेंट दैट वी विल बी कंप्लीटिंग द सबग्रेड वर्क्स within a budget of 22 crores, now we are completing in 15-21. So that means this part of work is going good and you are incurring a profit of 0.88 crore in this. So that is good. And this is 34.58, the sales price corresponding to 70 crores, right? See, so the total cost against this 34 crores of sales is 21.28. So you are incurring a profit of 13 crores in this. Earlier you have said that you will be incurring a profit of only 12 crores, but now you have incurred a profit of 13 crores. That means this particular scope of work is going within your budget. So that is, it is good. Now come to asphalt work, the road work, jo bitumen aap log lay karte ho. See, iska hai revised estimate 8.59 and your original estimate is 7.81. That means you have committed to the management that we'll be completing the asphalt works in 7.81 crores, but you are now incurring 8.59 because you have already incurred 2.14 and you have estimated that only 6.46 will be 6.46 more amount of rupees will be spent in executing this much amount of quantity. So the total estimates is 8.59 crore against 7.81. That means you are incurring a loss of 0.78 crores, 78 lakhs. So this you need to check. What you can do here, this 2.21, this already booked. So you're gonna do nothing. You're gonna do anything in controlling this 2.12. What you can do is you can control this 6.46. You've estimated that okay, 6.46 more crores will be spent in executing this much amount of work. So can I reduce this 6.46? I'll just highlight it here. Can I reduce this 6.46? Can I reduce this 6.46 so that I cannot incur a loss of 0.78? So if you are able to reduce this 6.46 by 0.78, you are 46 plus 32. So if you are able to complete this 6.46 within 5.6, then this will become positive, correct? So this 8.49 will reduce to 7.8 and then this will become positive. So this you need to check. Green item you need not to check because it was already green in color and it was already positive. So as far as it works, you need to check. So this is what JCR does. It at each and every month, it identifies this red highlighted item and we need to cross check and then we need to assess what can be done to make it green. I mean, suppose it is this report is prepared at the end of 1 month, right? In the next month, ho sakta hai, it is possible that subgrade might become negative and this part might become positive. So we need to check subgrade in that subsequent month. That is why this JCR is prepared every month, so that we need to keep a cross check on each and every line items whether it is going positive or negative. Just flooring works, the job status is nil because the works of flooring has not started yet, so there are no costs incurred. So estimate is 1.7 and revised estimate is also one, this plus this, so 1.7, and the our AC is 1.7. that means we are keeping it intact as per the AS. We are not going negative, we are not going positive against a sales of 2.05. so that this is the JCR that is prepared every month, which is a monitoring tool of estimate. This is the basic concept of costing in our organization. Now I'll just tell you some more topics of some more conceptual terms that are associated with costing. working capital. We apart from all these, we need to keep an eye on our working capital. Working capital means हमारे पास पूंजी कितनी है काम करने के लिए. What is an ideal project? An ideal project is a project in which our working capital is negative. कोई business तभी अच्छा कहा जाता है जब हम बोलते हैं कि उसमें हमारा पैसा ना लगे. हम client से पैसा लें और अपने contractors को pay करें ताकि हमारा पैसा ना लगे. एक बिजनेस अच्छा तभी कहलाता है. सो वर्किंग कैपिटल शुड ऑलवेज बी मिनिमम. हम पूंजी क्यों लगाएं अपनी, क्योंकि हम बिजनेस कर रहे हैं, हम प्रोजेक्ट कर रहे हैं. सो विल ट्राई कि वर्किंग कैपिटल आवर वर्किंग कैपिटल शुड बी एज लो एज पॉसिबल. सो वर्किंग कैपिटल विल बी इन सिंपल वर्ड्स वर्किंग कैपिटल इज करंट एसेट्स माइनस करंट लायबिलिटीज. आवर एसेट्स शुड बी मिनिमम एज पॉसिबल एंड लायबिलिटीज विल बी मैक्सिमम एज पॉसिबल बिकॉज अल्टीमेटली वी नीड टू पे. I know, but working capital we need to keep as negative. These are the general. You need not to go into that all details. Then another thing which comes, these working capital and ROEs. These are some financial terms which is also calculated during the course of the project, just to ensure we are on the right track. The ROEs is profit after tax divided by average net funds employed. See, where sales is your sales minus cost will give you gross margin. And gross margin, if you reduce regional overheads, HQ and A&M overheads, they give you PBIT. Generally, the management not talks about gross margin, it talks about PBIT, profit before income and tax, interest and tax, sorry. The management generally talks about PBIT, profit before interest and tax. How much PBIT are you going to earn from your project? Generally, the ROHU and A&M overheads are 3% of the sales. So sales is 70 crores, your cost is 55 crores, your gross margin is 55, your gross margin is 15 crores, overheads are 3%, so 3% of 70, 3% of sales. So 3% of 70 is, 3% of 70 is how much? 2.1 crores. So gross margin is 15 crores, 15 minus 2.1 is 12.9. So PBIT becomes 12.9 crores. That is what management talks about at the A's time. During the JCR time, it talks about where this 12.9 is going. Am I able to generate 12.9? Am I able to give my company 12.9 crores of profit or not? Then after deducting interest and tax from PBIT, we get PAT or net earnings. PAT means profit after tax. That becomes the numerator of the ROEs. Now I'll tell you the denominator of the ROEs. It is average net funds employed. It is also has a little formula. And ANFE is net funds employed is ANFA plus AWC. AWC is working capital, as I said before. Average working capital, we need to find out what average working capital we have. And net funds employed is average fixed assets net of difference. What assets you have? What do you call an asset? Your plant and machinery is your asset. So the net of depreciation means what are the fixed assets which are net of depreciation, which are due for depreciation. What is the average value? What is the average value of those depreciable assets that is kept here? So that becomes your ROEs here. So the ROEs becomes profit after tax divided by ANFE. What should be ideally ROEs? Can anyone please let me know? Higher ROEs is beneficial or a lower ROEs is beneficial? You can unmute your mic and then let me know. ROEs, it should be what ideal should be a ROEs? Positive, negative, zero, minimum, maximum? Anyone, please?
Anyone would like to answer the question?
You can unmute and then let me know what ideal should be a ROEs. If you have understood.
So I think they are pretty much involved in the PPT.
Okay. No issues. So see, I'll come back to my slide. I just have two more slides to go and then you'll be done. So average net funds employed, I've already tell you. Now economic value added. One more thing which generally the management is concerned about, what is the value addition to the project? What is the value addition to the project and what you have added by executing this project? Generally, most of the project awarded are based on economic value added. If the project is not adding any value to the organization, the management will not undertake any project unless even though it is earning profit. कोई project है आपके पास वो आपको profit earn करके दे रहा है but अगर वो economic value add नहीं कर रहा है तो management उस project को नहीं लेगी. Please keep this in mind. सिर्फ पैसा कमाना is not the objective of the project. It is the objective but not the only objective. Please keep in mind. So economic value addition is the most important thing which is there. So it is again all about profit and margin. So you have sales minus cost will give you gross margin, minus the overheads will give you profit before interest and tax. If you less tax, it will be PAT. If you less capital charges, it will be earned value added. Economic value added, what you say, and economic where capital charges here, which is to be added, is ANFE into 12.5%. This varies. This 12.5% is a typical formula. Suppose I want you all of you to calculate what is the what is the earned value added for the project of 70 crores. As I said, example, which has a cost of 55 crores as A's. So sales is 70 crores, cost is 55 crores, so gross margin will be 15 crores. You pay 3% of overheads, so PBI minus will come to PBIT. PBIT is 12.9 crores. Then you reduce tax. Suppose 1 crore tax is reduced, so your PAT will become 1 crore. Sorry, PAT will become 11 crore. So from the moment of sales to PAT, sales is forms. That means for a project of 70 crore sales, you are earning a PAT of 11 crores. And capital, if you less the capital charges, it becomes your EVA. EVA will be around 10 crores possibly. So for a project of 70 crores, you are adding a value of 10 crore rupees. That is what management talks about. Sometimes this may not be this 10 crores might be 8 crores or 7 crores. So it is not directly ki gross margin jitna jyada hoga, utna hamara EVA hoga. Suppose your overheads is more. So that means your PBIT will reduce, your PAT will reduce, and so your EVA will reduce. Suppose your gross margin is 15. In this case, I have given example, your gross margin is 15 and EVA is 10. So that means you have a difference of 5. In some projects, the difference has to be as minimum as possible. That means you need to reduce your overheads. That was what I concerned about. You need to improve your overheads. Overheads improved is directly added to the gross margin. So EVA is the net thing which is to be added to any project. That is all from my side. I hope I have covered a very broad aspect of what we follow in our organization. And this is the concept of cost management. To highlight and to sum up, this is the main grunt of the cost management. If you are able to monitor and prepare JCR every month, then you are able to control the project cost and hence you are able to control the project. That is all from my side. Thanks for being a patient listener, everyone. Any doubts, you can please raise and then I can be able to answer.
Any queries related to this? I don't think let me conclude this session for you all. Thank you, sir. It's a valuable session from your side, and we are so privileged to have you at this time, at this pandemic time. So now I would request HOD sir, Shiv sir, Sharma sir, to conclude the session.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So thank you, Mr. Rupal. Thank you very much for sharing the very much technical insights into the area of project cost management. Although the terminology, I think the students, the terminology for the students might be new. Because I believe that this is broadly covered under the project management subject, if am I right?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So unfortunately, project management is not taught very religiously in engineering institutes, although it is a very powerful project, and there are project management professional certifications also.
Yes, PMP certified professionals.
Yeah, yeah. So for the students, I can say that they, at their leisure, they may attend, they may read more material on project management. It is a very good domain, a very practical domain. So thank you very much for sharing the insights. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. My pleasure, that you invited. You gave me a chance to be part of this webinar, and my pleasure that I'm sharing my knowledge with all of you. Thank you so much once again, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Now I'm going to end the meeting. Thank you, everyone, for attending the meeting. Bye.
Thank you, ma'am.